EV vehicles today have become mobile IP addresses. Let's take a look today at how we can protect your automotive system and prevent these malicious attacks. Now, let's take a look at how we can protect your automotive system using our automotive ECU demonstration. In this demonstration, we'll be showing you how our DSPIC DSCs and our TA100s work together to protect your vehicle. Hi, I'm Josue, and welcome to the lab. Security in automotives today is evolving, alongside the complexity of modern connected cars that require ECUs to support security and the entire software framework to adhere to AUTOSAR requirements. Your car has become essentially a mobile IP address, but with these advancements in automotives comes the potential hazard of hacking attempts. Although not frequent, it's still a possible outcome which can endanger the vehicle and the passengers. Therefore, we created this demonstration application where we showcase the usage of high-performance real-time DSPIC33C digital signal controllers, or DSCs, combined with the TA100 CryptoAutomotive Security IC to meet the security and AUTOSAR requirements while implementing various ECU functions. In this demo, we'll be showing secure CAN FD communication with message authentication. Now let's take a quick look at the components we'll be using in this demo, as well as a quick overview of how they'll be interfacing with each other and each development board. First, we have here our low voltage motor control board. We'll be using this board to help interface our motor here. It's a three-phase permanent synchronous Hurst motor. In your automotive, this board here will be used to control or interface any motor-driven component. This could be, you know, a cooling pump, your air conditioner, etc. So, but here simply we'll just have it interface our motor to help kind of drive motor input and control the speed. This as well comes equipped with our TA100 within our 8-pin socket. This TA100 is a hardware security module, or HSM, that comes with cryptographic features as well as helps store your key securely. We also have our ATA6563 high-speed CAN FD transceiver that will help us connect with the other boards through our communication protocol. This board here will be used to interface the motor in your automotive vehicle. This component here can be used to control or interface to any motor-driven component. That could be either a cooling pump or your air conditioner. But here simply we'll just have it hooked up to our motor. It's a three-phase permanent synchronous Hurst motor. So it'll just be driving motor input and helping us control the speed. So on our low voltage motor control board, we currently have populated a DSPIC DSC device. It's currently our DSPIC33CK 1024 MP710 family devices, which are AUTOSAR ready devices. Next we have our Explorer 1632 Curiosity development board. For lack of a better term, this will be our communication hub. This will be helping interface to the rest of the development boards as well as our individual components like the motor here and our pedal. Currently, we have a DSPIC PIM equipped onto it. It's our DSPIC33CH512MP508 device, which is a dual core device. Now, for dual core, you can utilize one core to enable, you know, communication protocol, housekeeping functions throughout your system, and the other core will handle the more intensive real-time control and as well as motor control as well. So equipped here as well, we have our ATA6563 high-speed CAN FD transceiver, as well as our TA100, which performs similarly to the components found on the other boards as well. So here you'll be able to kickstart the demo by utilizing the switches here, specifically this third switch we'll be utilizing, but we'll save that later on for when we do the live run through. And then finally, we have our newest Touch Canlin Curiosity development board. Here, again, we simply have our TA100 equipped. The current device that is populated onto it, DSPIC, is our same family as our low voltage motor control board. It's the DSPIC 33CK 1024 MP710 family. But in terms of the the CAN communication, it's already built in with CAN FD input here. For this board, we really wanted to demonstrate some of the touch capabilities that our boards do bring equipped with our devices. So we have here a little touch panel that we'll be demonstrating later on to really show the touch capabilities that this device brings. So, okay, so let's take a look at the demo and then let's start hooking it up. Just before though, I have performed some, pre-installment work. So here actually, on our Curiosity development board, the Explorer 1632 board, I've actually soldered on the connector for our pedal on the back. It's just to provide a power as well as ground. And then here, these individual cables here as well were pre-soldered on. But this actually will be connecting to our Touch Canlin Curiosity Development Board, which will be providing it power. These two are very necessary. Again, this is coming from our communication hub, so that's why everything's kind of stemming from here. To get started, we'll be connecting our communication first through our Mocha FD box. So as you can see here, we have a custom cable actually that we created. This is just simply a ribbon cable with DB9 male and female head connectors. And then, you know, we use the crimping tool to establish each cross point. So you'll be needing to do that in order to be able to establish the connections. And so then you just simply connect it onto each board into our CAN transceivers. So we'll start here. Yeah, again, so as mentioned before, we made the we did some pre-installment work and soldered on the pedal connection to interface to our Explorer 1632 board. And so here we're just, you know, finalizing that connection. So now that we've hooked up our pedal, now it's time to connect our motor. So we'll be doing that and interfacing that through our low voltage motor control board. As you can see here, we actually be connecting it through these three little terminals right here. So we have our wires stemming from the motor. We have our black, white, and red. Now, the way you connect these into the terminal has no significance at all. You can put them in any order and you'll still help the motor function. So we'll be doing that now. Okay, now we have our motor hooked up, and we've connected the three individual wires to the terminal here. Next, we'll be powering up our Touch Canlin Curiosity board, which we have done with this power connector stemming from our Explorer 1632 board. Now here, the orientation does matter. This gray wire here will be our ground, while this brown one provides our power. So we'll be making that connection here on this board, our red Touch Canlin Curiosity board, this terminal with two inputs, which are also actually marked on the board. You can tell which one's ground and which one provides the power. So you got to really make sure that you make the correct connection here, or else it might short your boards. So let's do that now. Again, gray is ground. Okay, now that we've hooked up everything and made the correct connections, next we just have to provide some power and power up our development boards here. So we'll be using some power supplies, some pretty basic ones you could find really anywhere. The thing here is though, certain power levels are required for certain boards in this system we have here. So we'll be providing power to our Explorer 1632 board as well as our motor control board. And as well as actually our Mocha box, that's also will need to be powered up. So for these two, the Mocha box here, as well as our Explorer 1632 board, you'll need at least a 12 volt power supply to help power it up. Our Touch Canlin Curiosity board, the red one here, is actually gonna be powered up from our Explorer board. You know, that's why we made this important connection here. And then for our low voltage motor control board here, our last one, we'll actually need a higher output voltage for the power supply. So we've decided on 24 volt. So it's almost double that's being used on this board and the Mocha box. So now we'll just be hooking it up and providing some power here. So As you can see, we have lights, you know, flickering, so that's a good sign. And you know, the input for the power supplies is pretty self-explanatory, just pretty easy to identify. And then finally, our last connector actually hooks up to our Mocha box. So you actually need a specific connector here that we've configured. So you just hook it up simply here. So that's providing the power. And then for the Mocha box, you have this kind of twist on wire here. And yeah, you just simply lock it in into our Mocha box. And on the Mocha box, it clearly indicates which one's the power socket. So just plug it into there and got to match up the holes because it's a three-hole configuration. So, okay, there we go. It's latched on. Okay, so now everything's powered up. Let's give it a go through. Let's see what we can do here. So actually here, you're actually able to control it from the boards in terms of starting the motor, as well as turning on and off your security. So to start the motor, you actually have to click from your Explorer 1632 board. We have four switches at the bottom of our Explorer 1632 board, which we can actually use to start the motor directly from the board. So we have four, but we're using the third switch in order to activate the motor. From our Explorer 1632 Curiosity board, we could actually start the vehicle straight from here. So there's actually four button switches at the bottom. We'll be using the third one to turn on and off the motor. As you can see, the motor is spinning. That's kind of help you indicate the rotation a little better. I've added a small black tape here. So now if we turn it back on, as you can see, the motor is clearly rotating, and now we could go ahead and control the speed of the motor as well, since we've interfaced it to the pedal. As you can see, the motor is speeding up, and the rotations are becoming faster and faster. So it's actually pretty, you know, responsive to the pedal here. And then here from here as well, you could actually turn on and off the security, which is what we'll be doing. But it's kind of hard to demonstrate how the security is being implemented because we'll actually have to introduce our hacker attempts, you know, you can put it as. We'll be introducing that through the GUI that we've set up as well. So I can talk about that in a little bit. But this is, in terms of the demo setup, this is kind of the bare bones of what you'll be dealing with. Okay, now that we've hooked up the demo and made the, you know, the right connections, now it's time to hook it up to our GUI in order to introduce some hacker attempts and really see how this whole system reacts. So in order to make that interface between your PC and the CAN FD Mocha box, you'll be needing a USB to a USB type B connection. So the USB type B connector will be going into the Mocha box on the back of it here. Nice and easy. And then the USB will obviously be connecting to your PC. Okay, so the GUI interface you're seeing right now basically shows the status of the motor, the security, whether it's enabled or disabled, and as well as actually the touch panel, which you'll be able to see. And it's all very very responsive to what we're doing out here on the demo. So, but you will need this GUI setup in order to introduce the hacker attempts and really see the security that's being implemented through our TA100 and DSPIC DSCs. So the GUI we're using in this demonstration is actually through Optalizer Studio. And the GUI setup we've already kind of pre-configured, but you can find this as well on our web pages with the links in the description. But so the device, the Mocha box automatically populates to the device that's trying to connect here. And so if you made the right connection, you'll just have to reconfigure the device settings through Device Manager in order to match up to the connection that it's detecting through the Mocha FD box. So once you make that initial configuration, you should be able to get, you know, the correct pop-ups and current statuses of your system. We'll actually run through some of the security use cases first with the security disabled, so you can see what a, you know, typical automotive system would look like. So we can do that again here. And it's also indicated on the GUI, so the status of the security is red, which means it's turned off. Turning on our motor, which is, again, the status is indicated on our GUI. Just providing some quick pedal input to make sure nothing's currently affected. As you can see, it's quite responsive. Now, I'll be introducing some hacking attempts, commands, as you can say. One being motor stop, so the motor will briefly stop for a second and then continue spinning. And the other hacking attempt will be changing the speed, picking it up, so it'll be briefly sped up for a second or two and then come down back to its normal speed. But again, these are our commands coming from an outside party, you know, or any sort of hacker. So as you can see, very normal operation, motor spinning quite normally. We introduced the first attempt. As you can see there, the system is affected and the motor does come to a stop. So we can see that again. Even if for a second, you know, it's still being affected here. Now for the next hacking attempt, picks up some speed. And there's no pedal input coming from me. So this is all, again, a command coming from an outside party. So as you can, on the grander, you know, scale of things, you know, this doesn't look very detrimental here, obviously, but, you know, if you're on the road and an outside party or hacker is able to penetrate through that system, you know, even if it's for a second, it could put you as well as the vehicle in a potential danger and risk. So we want to make sure we can prevent that. And we can do that by enabling Microchip security features through our TA100 and DSPIC DSC devices. So we'll be running through that now. We turn off our motor. Now we enable security. As you can see, the status has changed to green on our GUI. And now we'll run through the same case studies again, security use cases. So turn on our motor here. Again, no more operation. Adding some pedal input to show that it's still very responsive to manual input. But we have security enabled now. So let's try again these hacking commands and see how our system reacts. First, we'll go with our motor off command. Once more. As you can see, there's no change. Now let's try our change speed hacking command. As you can see on the GUI, it is going through. The cluster is changing speed, but it's not reflected in our motor. So the security system that's, you know, built in this demo is actually recognizing the command coming through, but is ignoring it because it recognizes it as a cyber attack, a malicious attempt to penetrate your system. So those are the kind of security features that come equipped, you know, with not only our DSPIC DSC devices, but as well as our TA100 security IC element. So I think that's a wrap on our live run through of our demo here. If you're interested in any of the individual components or even the development boards or the firmware that was uploaded to each board, you'll be able to find the links to those in the description below. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe.